God, may the words that I speak this moment be your words only. And our hearts that we bring this day be filled with your love and your joy and your peace. In Christ we pray.
Amen.
In 1999, which, you know, seems like a long time ago, as I was serving as canon for pastoral ministry in the Diocese of Texas, I received a call from my boss, who was Bishop Claude Payne. And he asked me if I would go and visit this church in East, it was actually east of Houston, in Baytown. He said they had called and asked if I could come and help them work through some things. And he said, I want you to go and see what you can do and help them. Because the issue was they had had a rector who had taken a call to go somewhere else. They had a very young assistant, and she had only been married about, she had only been ordained about, well, she was married to Jesus, but she was ordained about 2 years. And they were having difficulty. They were having difficulty with a member of the vestry. And for some reason, he was always late to the meetings. And then when he was at the meetings, he was very disruptive and very difficult to deal with. So I was asked to come and be there. So there was a special meeting that was called, and I got there, and naturally, he was late getting there, and he walks in. He first of all sees the chancellor of the parish, which is the lawyer for the parish, and then looks over and sees me, and he said, uh-oh, something's going on here. And the long and short of the story is that the senior warden had met with him on several occasions to try to work through some things and try to get him to actually to behave better, and that didn't work, so the senior warden took the junior warden and maybe the treasurer, I can't remember, and they met with him to try to work some things out. As a last resort, they had a vestry meeting, and the vestry had to talk to him and all, and it still didn't work. So the vestry voted to remove him from the vestry. And the vote was 11-1. Of course, he voted not to do it. But, but that was a model that they used, which was from the canons of the Diocese of Texas. But that model is based on Matthew. I think that our canons, when it comes to some discipline things, are really based on Scripture, even though some folks may not really believe that. Let's step back a little bit and look at an overview when we look at our readings for this morning. They're all about rules of life. If you read the one from Exodus, which is about Moses getting ready to lead the people out of Egypt for the Exodus, it's about the keeping in communal memory that night about their Exodus that they will never forget. Paul reminds the Romans that the Ten Commandments really are based on one law, the law of love, the law of love of Christ. And Jesus outlines for his disciples the rules of dealing with church conflict, all based on the love that he, Jesus, exhibited and lived out. We need also to be mindful that in Matthew, it needs to be understood as a whole. Jesus is authorizing church leaders to follow a process to preserve the purity and the witness of the church. This may seem a bit far out, but church leaders are to protect the reputation of God and God's church. I want to share with you how I have seen this process that Jesus outlines, how it has worked in with church members who were somewhat troublesome or who had some problems themselves or was causing problems in the community. And I've already shared with you that first story of how that was acted out and utilized. Incidentally, that person, Bill, and his wife ended up transferring and going to another Episcopal church and seemed to be very happy there. Jesus's first approach is to go to the person. When I was in Victoria back in the 70s, there was a member of the congregation who I was very concerned about, who appeared to me had a drinking problem, and it was getting in his way at church, in his family, and at his work. He was an engineer. And so I went one Saturday morning to visit, and he was out cutting the yard, and he, you know, came in, and we sat down, and he said, "Would you like, you know, something to drink?" This was about 9 o'clock in the morning. I said, "No, I just had a bunch of coffee." He said, "No, I mean some tequila. I'm having some tequila. Would you like to?" I said, no, that's all right. He said, what's on your mind? I said, well, that's exactly why I came here. And I talked to him about my concern for his drinking. Well, it didn't work at that point. He got mad and quit going to church. And when people asked him why he dropped out of church, he said, well, it's that new prayer book that they're bringing in, and I don't like that, and I'm not going to go to church when they use that new prayer book. Well, that was his excuse. So I tried. Another person in the community you bring along. You share that concern with two or three other persons, and you may get that person's attention and act and be ready to help. And that's what Jesus outlined in that second process. And then Jesus' third part of the process, bring before the whole community. And this should get someone's attention about their behavior or about their problems. Like the story I told at first, this person came to the leadership of the church. And working with people who need to be in treatment today, we call this an intervention. Or in maybe in the church setting, we call it ganging up on a person. But it works, that intervention, when you have a particular situation. And Jesus was speaking out of his experience of trying to keep conflict out of the church. There are a number of times with parishioners, you lay out the problem and the concern, and those present share where they have experienced this problem with that person. You offer help and have an action plan. And in case of needing rehabilitation, it's been my experience when you deal with a person with intervention, you say, and we'll take you to this place where you can get some help. We don't say to them, well, you think about it and we'll keep talking about it. There's always an underlying motive is one's love for that person. That's why you do this. I remember some folks when I was in Waco where the family came to me and we met with the person who, in this case, was having trouble with their drinking and not knowing how to control or even to stop. And so some friends, the immediate family, the pastor, the rector, the priest, we came together, shared our concern, and then said, we will help you. And so we whisked that person off to a rehab place. And in every case that this was done, that person came back and thanked me and thanked the family for that help. It was a change of life. It turned their life around. And that's all from the model in Matthew. So there are some lessons and learnings for us. Interestingly, in Matthew, the author uses the word, you probably noticed it, the word church on a couple of occasions. And that was before it was supposedly used officially in Acts. So what's going on here? Well, I believe it's reflecting a Christian church at a more formalized stage of organization than really existed in our Lord's day. This was something after in the 60s and 70s AD that was happening, and it was placed in Matthew, and Jesus' words were used to somehow say, this is how we deal with conflict. The process described here is, in Matthew, serves to emphasize the need to do everything possible to maintain the Christian community, avoid schism or division, and win back those who have gone astray. You can see in this process that Jesus outlines just bending over backwards to try to retrieve and in a way to save this person. And I believe the point of this procedure is quite clear. Provide opportunity for repentance and reconciliation to maintain the well-being and unity of this new, fragile, growing Christian community. And this process, as I have indicated, is based on the goodwill of women and men and reflects Jesus' law of love. My friends, when we are confronted with a situation needing attention in our Christian community or even in our workplace or in our family or our schools, Jesus offers us a way forward to preserve the unity based on his love command. It is not easy work for those of us who have been involved in this. It's hard work. It's emotionally difficult. But we are not alone. We don't do this alone. Jesus repeatedly tells us, reminds us, he, Jesus, will be there to guide us and to be present. He reminds us of this in our collect this morning. And I want to just close with reading that again. O Lord, to trust in you with all our heart, for as you always resist the proud who confide in their own strength, so you never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy.